Hello, this is BSJ, and this video is going to be my first replay analysis on GameLeap that is in response to giveaways that we are now holding for users that will randomly be selected such that their replays will be analyzed by players such as myself for free. So this replay is a 3K MMR Anti-Mage player who I'm going to read off his notes such that you understand where he's coming from for this replay and then the things that I'm going to focus on when I'm analyzing the replay. So he said that he missed quite a few CS due to ping in the first 8 minutes or so. So I've elected to skip over the first 8 minutes because he said that he was dealing with high ping. But he says he wants me to focus on the mid to late game decision making. He feels like he farmed too aggressively at times and through the game despite his team and himself having good KDAs. He would also like to get attention on their lineup and how to deal with it. He says that they have 3 mana drains and that he was always out of mana. He purchased BKB, but it was never enough. He feels like most of his deaths were because he never could utilize his blink or his manta because of the fact that he had no mana to do so. So the questions that he had going into it was, did he fight and farm at proper times? So we'll be focusing on that in this replay. He said, should I have been more active earlier? Should I have just ratted instead of fighting? What could I have done to win us the game? So right off the bat, I'm going to look at their enemy lineup. So when he says that they have 3 mana drains, that the Jug ends up building Defusal because they have the Nyx Assassin mana burn and the Lion. So when I look at this game, I think to myself that unless I'm very far ahead, it's going to be difficult for me to farm. They have a lot of kill potential picking me off between the Lion and Spirit Breaker as well as the Nyx. Nyx scouting me out, Spirit Breaker charging me, and even Jug to deal the damage if he decides to come to the gank. But even the 2 supports plus Nyx could probably burst me down. And even though Zeus, you know, damage is magical, his ultimate still does offer a little bit of damage to help bring me down. So I'm definitely focused on, I'm going to try to fight whenever I can because of the fact that unless my team is fighting their entire enemy team, I am very vulnerable to dying at all times. So we're going to go ahead and move on past that initial point. And we're just going to see any mistakes that he might have made. If I'm fast forwarding or not noting anything not taking note of anything specific, that means I often will not have much problem with what he is doing. So oftentimes, this is something that I would say anywhere between like 4K and 3K carry players struggle with. So I didn't watch the beginning of the game, but my first idea is that there's a massive stack here. I'm going to show this real quick. So as a hero like Anti-Mage, there's like virtually no way for him to clear this. So I think one major issue in the early game was that this camp got stacked a bunch. So obviously I didn't see that in the replay, but something to avoid when you're playing heroes like Anti-Mage, Lifestealer, heroes that like slowly whittle down camps but can't actually kill stacks very well. You should be focused on either not stacking it too much like this so that you can never clear it until you have like a Battle Fury and it's vulnerable to be taken at any time. Or you should try to whittle down the camp whenever you do pull it. And if you're not able to do so, you just simply shouldn't stack it this much. Because this just serves as like, if Zeus or Jug just walks top and takes this farm, Jug can spin it down, Zeus can nuke it down with his Q a bunch of times. Either way, I think that having this big camp as not an option for you to farm, even if it's not given to the enemy team, will definitely be a big detriment to your farm speed. So it's something where the minute that he has no lane opponent, it's really important as a carry player to immediately gain as much as possible because you're no longer pressured by the enemy and you also have, you know, a tower that's potentially takeable. So in this kind of game, I look at, you know, who can kill me on the enemy team. And I think without Jug ulti and without Lion ulti and without Spear Breaker ulti, I'm very survivable. I'm very hard to kill right now. I can't imagine them bursting me before I blink with the given lineup without the ultimates they have. Unless they're able to like fully lock me down with Nyx into Lion, but that means that Lion has to like walk up to me and stun me. And I have full knowledge of where the enemy team is right now. So what I notice a lot, it happens in the mid lane as well as the safe lane, is when your enemy opponent leaves the lane, you just keep doing what you were doing before, staticking the lane and casually farming it. Right when somebody leaves, you should force them to come back because that is how, you know, pressure is applied from the carry position. So the first thing I notice is that he doesn't immediately start pressuring the lane. And this is something where if you're thinking about, hey, like, what is my opponent stopping me from doing, i.e. taking the tower, you know, farming and push-pulling with the stacked camp. That's why the stacked camp being stacked as much as it is a problem because he doesn't have that option anymore. If that was just a single big camp, he could have pushed the lane and then pulled at 953, farmed the lane like normal, and then farmed the big camp
also, and that would just speed up his Battle Fury by, you know, a couple minutes, even just, you know, 30 seconds, whatever it may be. But the fact that now he doesn't have that option, his really only option is to push the lane and pull it back as well if somebody comes and TP's. But if he had that option, he'd be able to push the tower, and then the minute someone TP's, he could just gain farm by pulling the wave. And if nobody TP's, he's taking the tower. So this is an important distinction. He does start pushing the wave, but it took him about a wave to do so. And now that it's under tower, he chose to go for a bounty rune. So what I look at this as a problem as a carry player is I'm not going to go for a bounty rune unless there's literally nothing else for me to do at the time. That's pretty much what I'm thinking, is almost every time if I'm missing a creep, if I'm missing damage on the tower, then the bounty rune wasn't worth it. Not only did he miss all of this damage that he could have taken on this tower right here, which literally took zero damage, but he also took a bounty rune from a Slardar who farms much slower than he does and would have, you know, had a blink that much sooner because he doesn't take the bounty rune. So he effectively just wasted his time going to the bounty rune rather than pressuring the tower. And that's all about asking yourself what heroes are needed to threaten me from stopping taking the tower or threatening the tower, as well as what items and levels they need to do so. And these heroes on the enemy team don't have the levels they need to stop him from pressuring the safe lane tower. So now that Nyx is back, you know, this is one of those things where if he barely doesn't get this tower, it's because he went and got that bounty rune. That's not something that's going to apply every game, but it happens enough where it matters for sure. So I definitely think this is a little aggressive because Nyx is here, but he does have Slardar to help him. But this is one of those plays. These are the kind of plays where I ask myself, what's my objective right now? And you've zoned out the Nyx here. I think that this initial aggressive movement to bully the Nyx away from these creeps, making it so that the Nyx can't take these creeps away from the tower, is really good. But the next question is, are you ever killing this Nyx? And the answer is almost always no, because, you know, you need Slardar to lock him down for you, and Nyx is the same level as you. It's not like you're level 8 and he's level 5. And then your goal is to get the tower. So your goal to get the tower was to draw him away from the creeps so that he couldn't take the creeps off the tower. And you already did that. Now it's time to back off. You've accomplished what you need to accomplish. But instead, he spends the time chasing the Nyx under tower, killing this creep wave, and he ends up almost dying. And these are the kind of spots where you'll die, you know, 20%, 30% of the time. And if you do this mistake, you know, 5 times in a game, you're gonna die an extra time. And that's just how I look at these kind of mistakes. He just didn't have to be that aggressive. So, like, immediately when I look at these kind of movements, what did we talk about your job was when the enemy left your lane? It was immediately pressure the tower and look for as much farm as possible. So when you have people show up in your lane like this, and you have supports that can take the lane, and your next question is, do I actually want to be here? Do I want to push this lane despite there being 3 heroes here? There are some heroes in the game that want to push this tower despite there being 3 heroes here because they want to keep applying the pressure. Anti-Mage is a hero that generally just wants to avoid all confrontation unless he's able to show up to like a team fight after it's already broken out and get some cleanup kills. This is a spot where the minute I see these 3 heroes, I'm either immediately TPing mid or I'm running mid because it's a free lane. There's nobody there and I can do the exact same thing that I'm doing top lane when they leave. I pressure mid tower, force them to react to my movements, and maybe that will open up top tower to be safe to farm and take again. But if I don't rotate, I'm not forcing them to go anywhere else. So now my lane may, it's going to be different every game, but my lane may never be inhabitable again. So this is where I definitely would go mid rather than farming this jungle camp. So notice that, like, you know, Zeus is just chilling in the top lane. And now it turns into, what do you know? Zeus was still able to be top. Nyx barely escapes. You guys end up losing 2 heroes. And it's like, it's not a surprise to me. And that's what I'm trying to emphasize, is that's something where because you didn't rotate mid and force any of the enemy heroes to react to that, they were able to have every single hero that they wanted to have other than the Juggernaut at that fight. So that really boils down to the fact that you chose to farm the small camp rather than TPing mid and pushing it in. Notice how the wave is just static on their hill rather than being under their tower. And that's the kind of spots where, as an anti-mage hero, any split pushing hero, that you force favorable engagements because you make them respond to your movements and you're more mobile than they are. And just notice how that big camp hasn't been an option for you. So I obviously didn't watch the beginning of the lane, but really pay attention to whenever you're playing heroes like this to make sure that you don't just eliminate that big camp as a camp for you. You're basically blocking the big camp next to your lane. So removing that farm. There's plenty of times where you could have pushed and stacked and pulled that camp where it's just a double stack and farmed it. But that's effectively just delaying that farm by that much. And if your support's doing it, try not to let them do it or tell them not to stack it too many times kind of thing. And if you're a support player, really try to think about how many stacks can my carry actually farm and how much is like an actual detriment to my carry. Okay, so this is an exact scenario like we saw at about 10 minutes. Two heroes just ganked you top and three heroes you see bottom. Where do you think you should go, right? Immediately go mid. There's no tower there, but pressure that lane in while it's safe to do so. Force them to deal with your movements. Maybe you'll force one or two heroes to go top, or go mid, excuse me, and then suddenly bottom lane becomes a fight that you can show up to because now it's 4v2. But you're immediately going to jungle a camp rather than pressuring a lane. And this is a game where once the enemy team gets levels and items, your ability to farm lanes is significantly reduced because of their ability to kill you. So instead you go back to top against a hero that threatens you in the Nyx Assassin. And this is where you basically just handed him a kill, right? And that's something where, you know, you're trying to be aggressive with your farming, but think about their heroes with Nyx, Lion, and Spiritbreaker. What's their method of winning the game? They don't flash farm. Their only way of winning the game is killing you. So avoiding them is really the goal. You went back top to farm. That's not your lane anymore. Let Nyx have that lane. You have a safe lane in the mid to farm rather than top. And this is something where a lot of players are anywhere between 3 and 5k, oftentimes do not rotate lanes at all in the first 15 to 20 minutes of the game. I did make, you know, a guide that is why you are 5k. You should definitely check it out in the Dota psychology section of the courses. And it's the same concept where the heroes, you just need to leave your lane. You return top here and you don't really have an option right now in terms of what lane to go to. Mid was occupied and bottom was occupied, but you'll notice in your games that if you stay in the top lane or whatever lane you started in for an extended period amount of time, you will get locked there because suddenly there becomes no other options because the map becomes so closed in on where you can actually farm. So not having a lane to go to now will oftentimes be because you didn't choose to go to a lane earlier. So if you look at the enemy team, their method of winning the game is killing you. And they have a lot of burst damage. And that is just boiling down to what talent you take at level 10. I think going damage here is incredibly greedy and unnecessary. Generally, I'll go damage if I feel like they are on a timer where they have light pickoff, but they have a lot of push where their goal to beat me is to end the game before I come online. And that's when I'll go damage because that speeds up my farm, speeds up my tower pressure. But here, my only concern is dying because of their immense amount of pickoff and damage. So I would go health. And I think that is incredibly greedy to go for the damage talent. So definitely these decisions in the early game delayed your battle fury by at least a few minutes. The death, as well as the fact that you had no big camp to stack, and the fact that you did not rotate the lanes when you had a lane to farm. You chose to farm like a small camp instead of a lane, which will give you slightly less gold. So it's really important to like gauge, at least like hypothetically, how much farm you lost by dying, by choosing to stay in your lane, etc. So you do end up taking this stack, and I can only assure you that like in an incredibly high level game, you know, 7k and above, that this stack would be gone far earlier than this. The enemy team would have saw it and they would have put a high emphasis on stealing it. So even though you end up getting it eventually, it did delay your battle fury, which is like a farming steroid for you. And it's something where, you know, you could have just had it. You could have had that equivalent farm by slowly farming the stack, and then had that battle fury would definitely speed up your farm far more. So I look at this and I just wonder, you know, no other lane has been occupied. These are often the times that you want to go to the enemy jungle, is when you see them all on your side of the map. You have ward vision to see when they TP to the shrine. If you push in the bottom lane, you'll have vision to see when they TP to tower. You should just feel safe in this area, at least until they are forced to deal with you. As a carry player, you're making it incredibly easy for them to pressure you. You're forced to sit in the trees safely and just chase you around because you're not actually moving around. You've been on the top half of the map for the first 20 minutes straight. And that's something where I really want people to realize that If you watch higher level carry players, just watch how much time they generally spend on their half of the map. Like, when do they leave? Like, how often do they rotate lanes? And this is something where it's hard to gauge exactly, but now they're all dispersed. They're all missing, and they could be anywhere. And now you choose to go bottom. I actually think you're at threat of dying because of what I just talked about. Earlier, you saw them all top, so if you'd immediately TP'd bottom, you'd have that space to farm. But now, I don't think you're actually safe to farm this creep wave, and you're feeling the same thing. So that's because you didn't... Okay, now you see Nyx, so you feel more safe. But that was because you didn't choose to react and TP to the bottom lane when they were all top. So now that they're all missing, even though bottom lane may be safe, you don't actually know. So you're forced to go back to the jungle camps, which is fine. Like, decision once you have that situation arise. But it's all about, you know, recognizing your threats. You see four heroes on the top half of the map and immediately going bottom. They're either going to not chase you and give you farm, or they're going to TP bottom and chase you, and then you blink to somewhere else on the map. Make it because you utilize your mobility in the blink such that they cannot keep up with you. So this is a nice narrow escape by yourself. Once again though, you are in a more dangerous spot down in the bottom lane because of what we talked about. You see all of them bottom, I would immediately run top. I would go straight to the wave top. Because you like, so you have to ask yourself, in the near future, is this jungle camp gonna be dangerous? If you see you have creeps pushing in mid, so if anybody walks through mid, you're gonna see them. You have a ward that covers the other entrance to your jungle. So when I gauge what farm I'm gonna take, I look at all the map and think, what farm is safe now? At this exact moment, I think that top and your jungle are both safe. So the next question is to decide which farm you take is, which one's going to be safe 30 seconds from now, guaranteed. And top most certainly may not be safe 30 seconds from now. They may put a hero there. They may rotate heroes to that side of the map, whatever. But you just saw all of them bottom. So that's why I immediately bolt for that lane rather than farming the camps along the way. I'm going to go push out that lane and then farm the camps on the way back. But if you farm these camps now, that lane may not be safe by the time you get there. And it may be safe this time, but that I can only tell you that's not going to be the case every single time. So now you should definitely rotate back through the jungle. So against this specific team, it's really important that this decision after Yasha. Yasha's just so efficient for Anti-Mage, I don't think it's ever correct to skip. But oftentimes I'll see like a 7k level player at this point go Yasha into Lincoln Sphere. And the reason why is your goal in your item after Battle Fury, other than the Yasha's just so efficient for a hero like Anti-Mage, is to give yourself survivability to their ganks so that you can farm faster. It's literally like, I need to survive ganks so I can farm faster. In this game, Manta actually gives you virtually no survivability to the enemy team's ganks. And that's Lincoln Sphere, because they can't charge you, they can't Lion Hex you right off the bat, they have to use abilities, and it's oftentimes you're just going to be able to get away. So mainly the charge into another hero. So this is a kind of fight that I'm not too ecstatic about. In these kind of games, your survivability goes up double or more with just like Lincoln's Manta, right? It's just going to double because, or even more, because like their heroes are burst heavy, so the health will be really nice, and then the Lincoln Sphere will just make it such that it's really hard for them to actually lock you down and initiate onto you. So these are the kind of fights where you should be ready to fight with a TP, but that's why you have a TP. You shouldn't, like, if you win this fight, where are you TPing to? And the answer is nowhere. So this is a case where you should never be at this fight preemptively. You should be here with a TP. And so what I mean by that is your farming pattern should be based off this. And what I was thinking about commenting on it earlier, but I wasn't sure if I wanted to. But now that this fight arises, I really want to note it. So you see that the Juggernaut's pushing bottom, and they're all missing. They're not farming their tower top, and they're not farming their tower, or their like the wave next to their tower top, and they're not farming the wave next to their tower mid. So based on map awareness, like if you utilize, you know, process of elimination, they're either four-man smoke ganking you, or they are all bottom. That's the two options, in my opinion. I think if you really consider it, that everyone else can agree. So what I would do in this case every time is, so I have a TP ready for the fight. If I didn't have a TP, I'd probably make my way towards bottom, meaning like my TP was on cooldown. But I have a TP ready for the fight. So then my next step is, if a fight is to break out, I want to have the option to either be there or apply tower pressure with split pushing, if that makes sense. You want the option. If it's not a good fight, that's the goal of showing up to good fights or not. Having the option between fighting and doing something else. So whenever you see a fight about to break out, so in this case, like we talked about, this is how you address map awareness. You see no heroes on the map and their jug is pushing bottom, even if those are just illusions, I can't actually tell from here, that they're either all bottom or they're ganking you. So your goal is you have to sit in a safe spot that prevents them from killing you, and then the minute that they show, you're able to take your objective as soon as possible. So I would debate that farming these jungle camps is actually dangerous, because if they are smoke ganking you, then you would die. But now that you see Zeus bottom, that almost guarantees that they're all bottom. Because while like Zeus isn't pushing a tower, he doesn't need to farm the wave, that almost guarantees they're all bottom. So instead of doing this farm, I would have immediately headed towards one of the two objectives that you feel like you can take if a fight breaks out and you don't want to show up. That being top tower and mid tower. So instead, you choose to farm on your half of the map, which makes it so that your really only option is to show up to this fight, because if the fight breaks out, you're not actually accomplishing something else elsewhere. So the important thing when gauging whether or not to show up to fights, which you asked about in your notes, is having the setup before the fight such that you have another good choice, so you don't feel forced to fight. But now you don't have another choice. You're not pushing top, you're not pushing mid, so you show up to a fight that your Queen of Pain, your main damage dealer, is already dead, and your Slardar is already dead. Imagine if you saw this and you were pushing top lane, maybe even pressuring the tower, and the minute that you see them leaving, because you have a ward to track their escape, you have all of this vision to see what they're doing after the fight breaks out. Say Spiritbreaker starts charging you and Lion immediately TPs, that's when you blink and then blink into the trees and then maybe TP bottom and go into their jungle, forcing them to react to your movements. But now that they're not getting forced to react, they're going to take a tier 2 tower of yours most likely, or just go for more kills without any cost to them. If you were pushing top and you had a Lincoln's, for instance, like a Lincoln's would allow you to farm top without worrying about getting charged and dying. And even though, you know, you don't have the money, or you wouldn't have it by now to have a Lincoln's, that's why, you know, you need to think about your itemization in terms of, if you had a Lincoln's, like if you went item next item Lincoln's, you'd have that option at any point when any fight breaks out to just push towers, right? Because you're not scared of getting charged. So you see all five bottom and just look at what you've accomplished in that time. You've effectively farmed jungle camps. So now they're all TPing top. You TP to base. I probably would have TP'd bottom shrine and used the shrine, because your time is so precious to push that bottom lane. Instead, you go back to jungling. I would immediately push the bottom lane because you're safe to do so, because they all TP top. But now, like, you're farming the lane. It's just like, look at how delayed you are in order to reacting. Like, this lane is safe to farm, I should go farm it. You should always take lane farm if it's safe to do so. So now they're all missing. I actually think you're in danger here, potentially, which you recognize as well. So you do back off. Notice how that little bit of time you didn't spend pressuring the lane could have been spent pressuring this tower now, and you probably get just that little bit of extra damage, maybe even take down the tier one. All of these little inefficiencies add up to how many towers the enemy team has left, how much CS you have, you know, how many fights they're able to take because you're not quite split pushing properly. So when you see them gank top, let's rewind that here. You see them gank top and you manta to push the wave bottom. This is a simple question of, why aren't you just pushing the wave with your hero? What are you afraid of? You saw all three top. The only hero that's missing is Lion, and he went Aetherlands, which I'm sure you could have checked at some point. I wasn't really looking. So how are you going to die bottom? Go ahead and use your hero to push the wave. Because the fact is, your hero has nothing else to do right now. All the camps are farmed. So I definitely think the major item decision problem is Lincoln's. It would really enable you to split push more safely and confidently. And that's like, when I had a coaching session the other day, I asked him, like, if you don't have a BKB on Ursa, and the enemy team has four stuns, what hero are you initiating onto where you're not going to get counter-initiated on and potentially die? And he gave me no answer. He said there was no correct hero. And I said, that's because you don't have a BKB. So that's a great way of addressing how to buy a, when to buy a BKB on Ursa. As an anti-mage, what lane can I split push confidently without a Linkets? And the answer is pretty much nothing, because they can just charge you down and chase you with Nyx and Lion and, you know, even just a Jug. So that's why you need to buy a Linkens. Your job is to split push, and you're only able to do that if you have a Linkens. That's why Yasha Linkens is much better than Manta here. And obviously you don't go Ags, because it's bad against Spearbreaker. It forces you to charge him. So really, your impact on the mid to late game is just nullified because you don't have a Linkens. You can't actually split push, so the enemy team's going to be able to force good fights, and this is just an itemization problem. You're not going to be able to do your job. You're going to feel like you're not able to do your job, and the reason why you can't do it is because you don't have a Linkens. Like, you could easily push this tier 2 with your real hero if you had a Linkens, but because you have no TP and you don't have a Linkens, if you get charged by Spearbreaker and, you know, two people TP in, you're eventually just going to get chased and probably die. So this is like a perfect example of, I'm not trying to harp too much on this one item choice, but the fact is it makes it incredibly difficult for you to do your job. And I don't think you're strong enough to fight them without, with just Manta BKB. You only have 13 armor, as well as the fact that you don't really do, you don't have any lockdown for yourself. You don't have any way to secure your own damage. So I don't mind what farming patterns you're taking with the items you currently have, but now you're just gonna struggle to find the farm. Because you, like, anytime you see a Spearbreaker, you have to run away. And so it's really important when your job is to split push as any hero to recognize what on their team is stopping you from doing so, and then what item prevents that, if possible. And Linkens definitely does that this game. So my point here is to not keep harping on one decision. It's to look at yourself in terms of how your decision-making is so affected by one item choice not being there. And that's something where, you know, in the future when you're playing a game, be like, oh, could I have done this if I had this item? And that'll just make your item decision-making that much better. Like, so you're forced to farm all these jungle camps safely, which is fine, you're getting farmed, but you're not actually applying any pressure in terms of split pushing. You're only able to use your Manta in order to push waves, which is not ideal on Anti-Mage, because your illusions don't get cleave, and they just don't push the wave nearly as fast as you do. So you're doing the correct thing. This is one of those things where you have a BKB. And I even said, you know, I don't think you are strong enough to fight with just a BKB. So you're building an item that's only purpose is to fight. And I would say you are not strong enough to fight. Period. I just don't think Manta BKB is enough. I think Jug can just man up on you. And Omni Slash, if you blink in, will still just kill you. If you blink in and he Omni Slashes you, you will just die because of your limited amount of armor. So I do like that you went for the all stats, because most of their damage is magical. But yeah, so this is a problem. You built a fighting item when that item is not enough for you to fight. So if you went, I would say, Linkens, Manta, Basher, and then BKB, suddenly you're looking really good to fight. The Linkens allows you to split push, the Manta gives you that output of damage so maybe you can show up to fights, and then the Basher gives you the lockdown so that you can maybe burst down single targets, and then the BKB gives you the immunity that lets you fight. But now that you built a fighting item that can't actually fight, that BKB, in my opinion, is effectively a waste. It doesn't speed up your farm, and it doesn't allow you to fight. You're still just going to get bursted like this. The BKB, in some heroes, in some cases, is what allows you to split push. It allows you to be effectively, because if they go on you with five heroes, if you just BKB, you walk away. But this is not that kind of game, right? The split pushing item would be Linkens, and then BKB is your fighting item. And because you can't fight, that kind of death is only happening because of the fact that you weren't able to apply pressure the previous 10 minutes of the game. And that's, like, really important to understand that, like, that death is a direct result of item choices 10 minutes ago. And that may seem, like, crazy to you, you know, like, wow, like, isn't that death just me out of position farming too aggressively? And the fact is, you're forced to farm the way you are because of your item choices. So while I don't like to harp on the same mistake over and over, I'm trying to show you the effect of one mistake such that you don't try to overanalyze situations like the one that just happened at the shrine. It's important to understand that generally one or two big item choices or like gameplay decision making styles, meaning like you think you can't split push or you think you're supposed to fight or whatever, that generally is what leads to most of the problems rather than like each individual death or each individual team fight that lost being individual, being treated as its own. So like notice, even though you have a BKB, you can't split push. And you also are not strong enough to fight. So now you're forced to defend base because you have fighting items and not split pushing items, but yet you're not strong enough to fight. So if you're playing a split pushing hero, generally speaking, if you build items like BKB and then you can't fight, that's when you have to ask yourself, what item should I have built so that I could approach the game from the split pushing perspective? Because the goal of split pushing in any circumstance is to get more items than the enemy because you're farming alone and just farming a lot more of the map, such that when you fight them, you can have those extra items and whatever item you need to fight. So you build items that allow you to split push first, and then after you complete those items, you complete items that allow you to fight because you have that much more farm than them. So when you're going for fighting items and then you realize you can't fight, that means you didn't build the enough split pushing items such that you could get the farm you needed in order to fight them. It's just a matter of order of items. So you guys end up winning a fight. And this is one of those things where, you know, I think you could have done the exact same thing if you, you know, had the items I was talking about. The BKB was really nice, but it actually, you know, it really didn't do much other than make the doomed Zeus run away from you there. And that's something where, you know, BKB would have been nice there, but I definitely would have rather you had a Lincoln's into a Basher there. So that fight was fine, but note that the problem with those kind of fights is if you lose that fight, you lose the game. And by winning the fight, you make the game drag on. And even though you have the highest net worth, you're still scared to fight. And that's a problem, like in a game like this, that if you're, you know, that you're not able to accrue more net worth or that you're not able to fight even though you are the highest net worth. And generally, this is meant to just, like I said, I don't want to keep harping on the same mistake. It's just generally, if you're this far ahead in terms of items and you still have to play this scared where you're manta split pushing and not actually killing waves, that generally means you built the wrong items. And that's something to look at any hero. That you have the highest net worth and you're still scared to do whatever your job is. That generally means that you built the wrong items. So I'm not a huge fan of the heart here, and we're going to see how it plays out before I talk about it. You guys end up taking a good fight. So what's really important to understand at any tier is getting as much done as possible when you kill the enemy heroes. So my question for you would be, what stops you from pushing high ground at any point in this game? Like, what hinders you from doing so? And I think it's mainly their burst potential with their stuns. I don't think Jug on his own is nearly enough, especially when the rest of your team is alive. So the minute that you guys get these three kills and you see the Jug running away here, this is when you immediately have to think, how much can I get done? I'm on a timer. I got 45 seconds till Lion's up, and I got 60 seconds until the other two heroes are up. How much can I get done? I need to force buybacks. I need to apply as much pressure as possible. That's done by killing waves and pushing it into their towers. So if all the waves are over here, then you'd have to just push waves. But because both of their waves on their both of the waves are on their side of the map, that's when you immediately go push waves, because you need to do things very quickly, very quickly. Instead, you go for mid. Because, oh, you actually have, no, you don't have creeps. Backdoor protection was on. It was just a glitch there. And now you spent the entire time where they have three heroes dead. You got no tower damage and farmed three jungle camps. And that's because you didn't immediately recognize that, oh, yeah, the three stunners are dead. Or the two stunners and their massive burst with the Zeus is dead. I need to do as much as possible while they're dead. And that's, this is how games in this tier last for 60 minutes. Because when you gain the advantage from teamfights, you don't force buybacks because you don't apply... You know, you don't put yourself on the map the way you should. So generally against mana burning heroes, it's even more important that you have full mana. So I definitely would have shrined there or gone back to base. I definitely would lean on the side of shrining. But my point that I look at on this heart is that in the end of the day, I talked about it earlier. I think it should be a Lincoln Sphere that was purchased before. And I think that this six slotted items would look just fine. And I would probably, like, if you replace the heart with a Lincoln Sphere that was built after the Yasha. And the next item I'd probably build is Butterfly. That's probably, I'd probably replace my Power Treads with Butterfly. And the reason why this heart is wrong is exactly what you talked about in your notes. Into the video. You said, I purchased BKB, but it was never enough for the three heroes that kept draining your mana. Heart's an item where if they go on you, on any hero, if they go on you and you live with any amount of health, that you're able to disengage and re-engage and still be effective in fights. When they have a billion ways to mana burn you, if they even bring you down to half and you live, because, you know, of your heart and you regen all the way back to full. If you have no mana, like, you know, to be blunt, you're a useless piece of shit anyway, right? So why would you build an item that helps you survive their initiation when if they just mana burn you, it doesn't matter if you survive? So this is a spot where you need to buy an item that makes you not get initiated onto, which is the Lincolns, and then buy an item like Butterfly that helps you deal as much damage as possible such that the fights don't last long enough for them to mana burn you to zero. So that's why an item like Heart here is just so, is just incorrect. And that's why, you know, you notice in your problems you said that you had, you know, all these times where you had no mana. And that's because you built items that kept you alive but didn't preserve your mana. You said you built BKB, but that only lasts for 10 seconds, and you can't pop BKB just when you're getting mana burned. So like here, you're going to survive, most likely, because of the fact that you have so much health. But notice how, even though you have so much health, you know, you barely escape, and now you can't turn the fight anyway. And you're going to die because you have no mana. So that's why Heart was just simply wrong. Because no amount of health matters if you have no mana. So fast forwarding, I believe I've seen pretty much all I want to see. I've seen your six slotted items. I've seen your early game to mid game decision making that was severely hindered by the fact that you don't have a Lincoln Sphere for your split pushing. And I've also seen that you had a TP when you could, so you could have been pressuring other lanes. Instead, you chose to wait around and see if a fight breaks out when you could be pressuring elsewhere and then TP to the fight if it looks good, which gives you multiple options. And all these factors are making your item progression slightly slower, such that the enemy team can get more items by the time you're six slotted, and then also making it such that you're not ending the game with pressure, noticing how you're still getting mana burned. So even though you had a heart to survive there, it just doesn't matter. You are still useless, and you're seeing it here. You're not able to utilize your mana to manta. You can't bring targets down that you want to actually kill. You can't actually ult anybody to finish them off. And that's all, this is almost all itemization in my opinion. And the goal of itemization, I talk about it in all of my coaching sessions. I'm honestly going to wrap up my replay analysis here. Itemization is recognizing the way fights are going to break out, what your job is in the game, and then such that you can like play the fights the way you want, and then you can do your job. So your job was split pushing, that's why you needed a Lincolns. Fights are going to be that if you don't kill them, they're going to crowd control you and burn your mana. So if you build items that are meant to just live, in terms of the heart, then you're just going to get your mana burned. And that's really important to understand that, like, after a game like this, that maybe you didn't know this beforehand. But now, if you look back on this game and analyze for future games, as any hero, to imagine how the fights are going to break out and why it went wrong. So you gave me all of these concerns about you having no mana. You asked, did you fight and farm at the proper times? Should I have been more active? Should I have just ratted instead of fighting? And what could you have done to win this game? So when I look at this game, I think about the itemization that we've already talked about numerous times and really hashed it out. We talked about the fact that you didn't set up around team fights, meaning that team fights were potentially going to happen. So what you need to do is, as a split pushing hero, you need to be somewhere on the map such that if the fight breaks out, you can push a lane and a tower, such that if you want to show up to the fight, you can TP to it. But if the fight's not good, you're still applying tower pressure instead of farming neutrals like you were. Because in that case, if the fight's bad, you're probably just going to show up and do nothing, because that's the time where you're like, I'm just farming woods, I guess I'll just show up. And then, or the fight's good and you'll win it, but you would have had the same scenario happen if you're pushing the other lane. So it's one of those things where giving yourself multiple options makes it so that good and bad fights still have something accomplished by you. But in the way you're playing it, bad fights make it so that you are accomplishing nothing. You're not pushing waves. Nothing good comes out of your team losing two or three heroes. So you asked if you should have ratted instead of fighting. I think you, like I said, you can still fight with a TP on you. That's why you have one. So play the game like you have a TP. Why do you have that TP if you're not going to utilize it? You know what I mean? So that's a spot where, it falls in the same line as that. And then what you could have done to win this game, I think I've already talked about this enough. The couple times that people died, you didn't utilize the time to its fullest to get objectives done. You weren't split pushing lanes when the enemy team was threatening a team fight engagement. You didn't rotate lanes in the early game such that it allowed them to stay in your lane, pressure you, take a good fight in the top. Something we talked about. We said you could have rotated mid-forced reactions. It's not a surprise that you didn't do that, and then the enemy team four-man fought you in the top lane and killed two of your heroes. Those things are directly connected. So past that, really looking for openings on the map, like when I talked about in the early game. You know, if you see heroes somewhere, what heroes on their team are stopping you from doing what? Like, what is the Nyx stopping you from doing? What is the Lion stopping you from doing? What is the Spiritbreaker stopping you from doing? And if you think about that, then the minute you see them, guess what? You're going to do that. And that's, like, exactly what you need to do to be the most efficient split pusher and having, you know, increasing your map awareness and your effectiveness on the map. So I hope you guys enjoyed this first replay analysis by BSJ. A lot to learn from this game, I believe. And I look forward to doing more replay analysis in the future.